Any successful man, there is always a great woman behind him. So let's teach you a little bit of things. So one time, the husband tells his wife, I want to buy a land, piece of land. Wife asks, what land? Okay, just laugh. It's a Chinese proverb. Just draw near to the Lord. God, I want this piece of land. The land that is set on you. Tell the Lord what I will set, dedicate this land to you. That we want our heart to earnestly seek God. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for your presence. That this earnest seek is easily lost. That we just want you, your heart, that we desire you, your presence. Just like deer pant for water. So give us want to walk with you alone. So every day that we want to seek you and be near to you. So give us this heart that will seek hunger for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Summertime now, do you feel like it's getting warmer and warmer? Last week, that even indoor, it was like 80-some degrees, pretty hot. I think next week, possibly going to reach three digits and hundreds. The heat wave is coming. So wondering what you want out of that. Do you want to drink water, right, when you get warm and hot? Our body craves for that. We want some ice cream, right? All these are natural reactions. So if we invite people to go out, and then we're sweaty and tired and thirsty and we're tired, and then a person says, Lord, my heart desires you, that I want to seek you. What would you say? You touch their head and say, are you having a heat stroke? But there's a person in the Bible that when he are so tired and about to faint and dry that he seek the Lord. Let's read the word. Let's read the Psalms 63 by King David. Let's read it together. Oh God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, and my flesh faints for you. As in the dry and weary land, and where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. In your name, I will lift up my hands. And continue once. Let's read it all. My soul will be satisfied as well as fat and rich food in my mouth will praise you with joyful lips. And when I remember you up on my bed and meditate on you in the watches of the night. For you have been my help, and in the shadows of my wings I will sing for joy. My soul clings to you, and your right hand upholds me. And keep going. And those who seek to destroy my life shall go down into the depths of the earth. They shall be given over to the power of the sword, and they shall be a portion of jackals. But the king shall rejoice in God, and all who swear by him shall exult, for the mouths of liars will be stopped. So let's return to page one. I mean, first phrase, first verse. So as we can see here, so in a dry and weary land, that's where he seeks the Lord the most. Earnestly wants to seek the Lord. Do you know when he was this song was written? Especially when he was thirsty, right? But he was being chased after that when he was in the dry lands of Judah. The second time that he was been chased, the first time that he ran, it was chased by Saul, that his father-in-law, that was his own father-in-law going after him. So why would his father-in-law go after him? Because he's extraordinary, outstanding. He was victorious after winning battles. So there are knights and women that would sing certain songs. Do you know what they sing about? That's right. Saul had killed for thousands and David kills for tens and thousands. I can't even stand that. How could Saul would stand that kind of song, right? He was so angry. It's like thousands to him, tens of thousands to him. I'm so angry. So from that day on, he was so jealous of David. He wants to kill him. He sent him out on a difficult mission to kill enemies, and he still came back victorious. All kinds of plan and plots, and want him to come in, to play strings for me, and then pick up this spear and want to accidentally to want to kill him, but David actually slipped away. So he wants to kill him in all different ways. One day, David realized that I have to run. That you can't beat the king, right? Nobody can beat the king, right? I can just run for my life. So he ran to the wilderness. That's the first time he ran away. Saul sent 3,000 soldiers to go after him. 3,000 soldiers, not just civilians, 3,000 soldiers. So difficult. So he ran for 6 to 8 years. He was only his 20s, and he reached age of 30 that he became king of Judah. He thought when he was 60, once again, he has to run to the wilderness. This time, it's his own son, his third child, that come and go after him. Why would his own son want to kill him? Because he wants to take over his throne. He wants to be king himself. Why'd that happen? Because his oldest son. Because his first son have raped the third son's daughter. And the third son was like, "Man, daddy's not taking care of this. I'm so angry." He held that in for 2 years. When he get an opportunity, he killed the first son of David. And then David ran. So he went out his own country. 3 years later, he returned. His father loves his sons, but he has sinned sexually as well too. So he feel like he has no power to. He had the same weakness, and because of sexual immorality, he killed other wife's husband. Even prophet has spoke to him that he had to repay four lives because he killed her husband. That's how the law is about Israel, that if you cheated someone, that he had to repay in four folds. So that's what happened. So he was running again. Her son returns, that they were no longer close to one another. When the third son came in, they never met one another. His son gradually started networking and wants to win over the hearts of the people. In 4 years' time, that he wants to take the throne himself. So he wrote this song when he was running away. So when you're dry and weary, just drink water. But what would he want to write that he would want to early seek the Lord? Because what his heart desires is so much greater than what his body needs. Even as he was running away, he will have water and food people provided to him. But he can only be strengthened through desiring God. So that's why his soul thirsts for God. That he talk about in verse 2, that I have looked up on you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory, right? So what happened? That I have looked up on you and behold your power and glory. This once look up on, it's not about, this is a complete term that continuing on, I will continue beholding. So in verse 7, he's talking about that Again, that you, what have you done in the past, and continue to be in me, continue to see God's good work, and continue to deposit God's power so he can be strengthened. He needs to continue to count his glorious, what Lord has done in him. So God is glorious, his attribute, and how God provided for him and helped him. So how God had become his salvation, and how the Lord helped him, even when he's in the wilderness. So that he was, as a kid, he was able to fight bears and lions, and when he gets older, he even killed the giants, Goliath. So that all battles that he was sent, that he were victorious. So God has protected him. 3,000 soldiers coming after him, but God still helped him. 2 times that he could have killed King Saul, but he didn't. God let everybody in the tent camp were sleeping, but he could come in and take things away from Saul, and no one would notice. One other time, that there were so many caves that he wants to release himself. And then he happened to be in the same cave. He could have killed King Saul at that time, but he still didn't do it. But he knows God is in control of everything, that he will continue to count God's miracles, that he will have the strength to continue on. It says that I earnestly seek you. So even in the morning that I want to seek you. He says what? Even that night when I'm in bed, I will still remember you. It's about what? Just remembrance of you. Continue to go down, you see. That even at night, that I will meditate about you. Anybody here will meditate on God in the middle of the night? The only people who could go to sleep? If you're a normal person, you probably will fall asleep, will not meditate on God, right? So you must have such a great measure of pressure. You know, if you've been chased by your enemies, will you have a good night's sleep, quality sleep? We have experienced things like that. So pressures, afflictions, and troubles that we were in, that makes us sleepless. There's 24 hours in a day, 12 hours of daytime, 12 hours a night, right? God's rule, right? So there's morning and night, day and night. So there's 3 quarters each time, 4 quarters. So you couldn't fall asleep, even in the early hours. So some of us have this kind of experience of sleepless nights. Have you experienced sleepless nights? There was a brother. That he realized that his daughter was dating someone, having a boyfriend, and he had a sleepless night. Imagine if you're dating someone and have a girlfriend, you probably have sleepless nights too, right? And some brothers and sisters, perhaps because the work, too much work, then they couldn't sleep, right? Because they're reaching their deadline, they couldn't finish the project, they don't have sleepless nights. Sometimes we have financial troubles because of your challenge financially, that you can't go to sleep. Or if you have sickness, diseases, and the loved ones are sick, they can't go to sleep. Myself, I have experienced sleepless nights for half a year, 6 months. I suffer insomnia here and there. My father had cancer. In the last stage of cancer, he was about to die. He wasn't doing well. So I bought airline ticket to return to see him. That day, I arrived in the afternoon, but my father passed away in the morning. To me, I was so shocked. I feel like so regretful. If I just bought the ticket a little bit earlier, originally I was going to return a couple of days earlier, but I have work, so I couldn't finish. And then I was 2 days late, and he left me the morning of. I have such a self blame. When I know he was still in America, I didn't spend time too much time with him. I should have spent more time with him, I feel like. It's such a self blame. I wasn't a good son. I didn't call him enough. I didn't talk to him enough. Such a shame on myself. I just locked myself for two nights that return. I wouldn't talk to anybody. I feel like I should have go comfort my mother, but I didn't. I was in the self-accusation, and I was in such a shame in myself. In my return, for about half a year, I suffered from insomnia. Then I would just come before the Lord. Then I will meditate on His goodness, Lord, that You have helped me, that You helped me to see Your power and glory, and what You have done, my father, that will count for them the good work that He's done by my father. My father has experienced this journey, how faithful God was, that someone who is the last stage cancer, a pancreatic cancer, that he can no longer rely on morphine. He was in this painkiller that was like four times stronger than morphine. But God listened to my prayer. And then on my birthday, that he did not suffer, God removed his pain. He was peaceful. He no longer need any painkillers. Even on the day he died, that he was singing when God took him away. God has such a wonderful miracle that happened in him. How he helped him, that when he couldn't speak English very well and still have a great job, God has blessed him his whole life. Because we know the Lord, that our relationship, family relationship improved with his own spouse, with his children, myself, my sister and brother, we have restored our relationship. And he was healed by other physical problems, that he had many God's good work on him. And then he became an evangelist and brings a lot of people to church. Often he will bring people to church. God has such wonderful blessings on him. That God says, you have to meditate on my good work. That what blessings my dad had passed on to me. But God used my father to love me, to love you. Do you see that? Do you see that love? He always gave us the best to his children when we go eat out. All the good food he will share with us first. If you go there to eat roast chicken, that my younger brother loves the wings, and my sister loves the chicken legs, and I will eat the breast and chicken breast with my mother, and he will eat whatever's left. We thought he just liked the bones. He just wanted to eat the head and the throat. No, he's just eating our leftovers. Not that because he loved to chew on bones. He always eat last. So God revealed to me one after another through his love to show me a fatherly love. So what is a fatherly love? God, through my father, that he has certain inheritance that he wanted to leave to me, that he is a businessman, that he always hold on to his promises, he never breach his promise to his clients, so his clients will do business with him all his life. Even when after he immigrated to Canada, people still want him to minister their houses to sell, and he will continue to, just because they trust him so much. He has a wonderful character that become my inheritance that I learned from him through his father. And let me see through him that he has released his inheritance to me and released his life. God want me to meditate on it. What has he done in all over this matter so I will know his heart? I believe that we have challenges in hard times in life, but yeah, always want to return to the Lord, especially in trouble, that even in the darkest nights, that when we couldn't handle it, that we will have to learn from David to meditate on him. What do you want me to know? What do you want me to see? I want to see the goodness that you have done in the past. Now you got to show your glory and power in me once again so I can remember. Show me your life. I want to see that you're helping me. How you have supported, provided for me, and helped me. How you strengthened me in the past. This is how God led me out of this depression. So every time I feel depressed, that I have to gaze upon him. Like David. That your love is greater than life itself. In his most troubling time, that while I'm alive, I will praise you. While I'm still alive, I need to praise you. He was to the point about to get killed and hunted down. His own son was hunting him down. He said, while I'm still alive, I still continue to praise you. That when you raise your hand to the Lord and praise God and pray to him and then release your thoughts to him. This is what David has, how he walked out of darkness and walked out of his depression. The first time that he got chased, hunted, even the second time he got hunted, he did not hold any grudges against God. There are no grudges. Even the first time that he was able to keep the king that was going to go after him, but he didn't. He continued to come to God. This is what he's done. He returned to the Lord always. Even his most difficult time that he chose God. In the darkest nights that he chose God, I need you. So my heart can be strengthened. My soul can be strengthened. This is a warfare. Do you understand? Every time we turn to the Lord, it's a battle. He's not naturally that he will want to cling to God. Nobody will be like that. Every time, every warfare, every battle he has, that he has to pay a price. He had to fight for it. That I want to turn to Lord. My heart needs to turn to the Lord. That I will follow you closely, God. That I will focus on you, God. It's the same word that they describe how Caleb that go after the Lord. That he wants to seek him earnestly. Same word. That I want to follow you. That you are my only. David's like that. So when he's trouble and difficulties, he first priorities turn to God. You know how many of us that you're experiencing hardship inside. Just have a little time that we come before him. That all the worried and depressive things, or even you've been accused and persecuted, you have to surrender to God. That he has a lot of weaknesses, that he has stole someone's wife. He has a lot of weaknesses, not perfect. But every time he turned to the Lord, he received healings and restored. Today, we need to turn to God. Now let's close our eyes for a few minutes. That we surrender our burdens and heaviness to the Lord. There's things that worry us in the middle of the night that we couldn't sleep. We surrender to you. Jesus, we thank you for helping us, that you are our strength. That you are our song, your salvation. Especially in the most difficult times, and we get up and praise you, and raise our hands for you, in your name. Especially when we're having difficulties, that we will meditate how you helped us in the past, and how you are our salvation. Strengthen us, Lord. Be among in our midst right now.
And
especially in dark times, difficult times. In the middle of the night, when we're alone and feeling helpless, and we couldn't sleep at night, that he gave us strength. That your heart would turn to us, that we will want you only. My heart and soul desire to see you. That I earnestly want to seek you, God. Thank you for having us. That draw us close and keep us. A minute or two, that I surrender your difficulty to God. Because he remembers you. That he will take care of you all of your life. Thank you. Dear Jesus, thank you that every time that we experience difficulties in our lives and challenges, that you want to help us to see your power and your glory. Thank you, Lord, that you want us to see, even in troubling times, that we get to know you, to know that you are a help. To know that this whole way you have never forsaken us, that you always use your right hand to hold on to us, that your hand could hold on to thousands, and you're helping me today, that you're going to hold on to our lowly hearts, that give us the joy in the strength in you, so that we can testify of your goodness, to testify that you're a good God, that you are our salvation, that you are our help. Jesus, we thank you for the full life of count our blessings to get to know you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God sometimes uses difficult times in troubling times to get to know him more. So we'll know how, what kind of God I worship. So you can think about how he brought you out of the sins, gave us strength. Other ways that he will teach us how to be strengthened through service. When you serve, that you'll get to know yourself, that you will know what angers you, that you will know through service that I can be angry and then I will forget about God, when I will drop in a really low mood. Sometimes when I serve, I lose peace and you might lose her joy because you're not really serving God at that time. Through ministry that sometimes we'll get to know, I will give time to my wife, to Irene, Mama Irene, that she will share about serving. Brothers and sisters, peace to you. These times that in our home groups that we listen about serving. So let's review Romans 14, 17 and 18. Let's read it together. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Whoever thou serve Christ is acceptable to God and approved by him. So that let's pursue that makes a peace for the mutual building. So Jesus says that the kingdom of God is not a matter of what eyes can see. It's not about you can see it here and there, because God's kingdom is in your heart, it's inside of you. As God, we cannot see the kingdom in King David, but when he experienced through his suffering in his heart that he had done so much work that we can't see. Every one of us, he has done wonderful work inside of us as we connected to the Lord, as we seek him earnestly and love him and to desire to search him and need him, because we know none of us that there's anything we can do without him. So in his presence, that we're so full of filth, that before him, that we're willing to connect to him, that his righteousness, that his peace, that his joy in the Holy Spirit will fill us. No matter where we go, it's not about what we have done for God, what we have done for people. It's his life that he's working in us, so other people can see God through us in our lives, that can see God. Every stage in our lives that we will experience Him differently, that we'll encounter different, experience different people. Sometimes we may have a lot of times that we are serving our family members, our parents, our in-laws, our children. Sometimes God allows us to serve in the marketplaces, to our employer, to our co-workers, and customers that we encounter. Sometimes it's in school when we were learning that we can serve our teacher. Sometimes that we have opportunity that in church we can serve other brothers and sisters in Christ, especially new believers. Not about what you have done, so that our life in different stages, that God's life will flow out of us, that people can encounter God's goodness, God's love in us. I want to share about one of my ministry, our church, how God has built in me. I've been here 20 plus years to this church. I remember one day I was in the bathroom that I came across Pastor Martina. I don't think she knows me at that time. And she says, Irene, do you know how to play piano? Yeah, I do. I love playing piano, but I'm not that good at it. And she encouraged me, continue to practice. Then you can serve God that way. So I was obedient, and I practiced very seriously, technique and all, practicing. I was in a Pure Heart family group that I was preparing myself, listening to the inner life messages, and then I have opportunity to be able to be a pianist and bring worship. Even though I like to play piano in peace, but inside of me, I have this thought that I'm not good enough. One of the reasons is because when I was young, one of my piano teacher told me that your hands looks like jellyfish. You know, like you're so slippery. Like, you know, she says that I am formless because you can't hit the right keys because you're so formless that you will slip off, that your hands not steady enough, and your beats are not accurate. And one other time, a weakness, I couldn't hear some low keys. Not when someone speak lightly, I couldn't hear what they're saying either. Sometimes when people call me from behind, I didn't respond to them inside because I ignore you because I can't hear you from behind me. When people are praising loudly in front of me, someone want to talk to me from the side. One time, Mama Lily came to me, want to say something next to me. I heard so many times, like, I'm trying to understand what she's saying, but I couldn't. I can't hear, couldn't hear her. So I had to trust in faith. What is she trying to say to me? So to me, as I was serving, hearing difficulty and with skill-wise is difficult for me. So through my serving journey, many opportunities that people will correct me, that you can improve on this area, and you can strengthen here and there. I get a lot of criticisms. I'm willing to listen to these, but I feel like I don't think I can reach that standard. I feel like my attitude, I have such a high standard for myself. I want to accomplish things quickly. I want to, like, a sudden change. I want to be better quickly. But it's just never in my own timing. I didn't improve over time so quickly. I didn't have my breakthrough. So sometimes I feel depressed and disappointed. I feel like, wow, I should just stop serving. Other people are better than me. Why should I hold up the space? But I know God has such a calling for me in worship to serve Him. Many times, after the people give me suggestions while I was playing keys, sometimes I don't think that will happen. During that time that these kind of accident will happen, that everybody was just singing, I couldn't play the keys anymore. I feel so that I didn't do a good job. I feel like I value my self-worth about what I have done, what I have accomplished, about my performance. Since I was a child, that the adults will always compliment me when I, had 100 on a test. Oh, you went this and such a word. That's all about what I have accomplished. And that equates to my value. So during this journey of serving, God continued to change me. That He values who I am, what He values who I am than what I do, and He really cares about me. A lot of times, I will feel sad. I'll come before God. That He will let me know how He delights in me. That I'm so willing to serve Him, not because of what I accomplished. So many times, I will come before God. I feel that His pure love for me, that how He truly likes me. Like the beginning of our worship time, such a passion and joy that He created each one of us, that we all, no matter what we've done, no matter what we've done, I feel like God has just continued to change me in this area. So I feel like that I can grow in His love, that I'm no longer trying to rush to improve my techniques with breakthrough, like a standard I impose on myself. But God wanna offer our best, of course. You want that heart of excellence is good. But my motive is about to get value from people. That I want to find my worth through people's valuation. But God shows me His acceptance, His love. It's not contingent on what I perform. It's about who I am. Yes, I believe God's word. Every time I go and wait upon Him, draw near to God, I can feel how He delights in me, how He loves me. Every time we wait upon Him to draw close to God, that you'll give this opportunity to build in us, every one of us, like David, his heart, his soul, earnestly seek, Lord. Is to come before Him, that his soul wants to connect to God, no matter what, no matter what the environment is happening, whatever I feel like inside, the chaos of thoughts and lies that are flowing in, but my heart earnest seeks Him. I don't know when it happens. It's really, it's been years. I don't know how long it took. But God gradually, that He built His peace in me. That peace in me. That shalom. So I realize it's not about how good I've done. It's about how I rely and trust in His peace that will flow out of me. One time I remember, Stephen and I started to serve at a conference. I remember I don't have much of a duty. I don't have to play keys, piano. I don't have to do any administrations. All I needed to do is just be with children at a children ministry, to be a helper, to smile at children, embrace them, hug them, and say hi to them. That's all I had to do for a few days. And if conference is done, I feel like I'm so useless because I want to do something. I want to do things. I want to do. Even if you ask me to clean the restrooms, I'll be okay with it. I feel like my value is based on what I've done. Just smiling at people, I feel like I didn't accomplish anything. But you know what? On my way home, God illuminated to me. I was there. I was there. And when I smiled, that was enough for him. He does not care what I have done. He wants the children to feel security and peace.
The
best thing I've ever done. So, it's not easy for me. This whole journey of serving, he continued to construct me. Even at home, Stephen knows I love to do work. But you feel like I'm strange. I really enjoy doing chores, cleaning up the house, doing dishes, and sweeping. I want the house to be squeaky clean. I love it. I feel so accomplished after I do all these chores. I don't feel like I'm wasting time doing these houseworks. I love to do it. Stephen is... My love language is about servitude, about servicing. Pastor Stephen oftentimes would tell me, I love you. I love you. I see you and my heart is so happy. He can just say things like that to me. He'll look at me like he's so in love with me. At the beginning, I thought it was so stupid. Why are you kept saying you love me? But I feel like he say a lot more than what he does for me. He's continuing to tell me the things that he loves me, that I like you. I'm so happy to be with you. But I feel like I'm still trying hard to receive what he released. Because I feel like I didn't do nothing. In the morning, you can say things like, I love you. I haven't even done anything and you love me. When I open my eyes and he says, I love you. I have not accomplished anything. I feel like Abba Father is how he sees us. In the morning, you don't have not done nothing. My hair in a mess. He sees us, child, I love you. Then I continue to understand that how God sees us through his love, so we can be transformed, that we no longer we're not a human doing, we'll become a human being, so we'll become his righteousness, his peace, and the joy in the Holy Spirit. Okay, I will share it here. So, can you go back to the other verse Sometimes when God says, I love you, we can hear it well. Sometimes I have to say at least three times before she'll notice. But God want to remind us this, that how he loves us, what he cares about who we are and not what we do. Sometimes we want to do and perform. But God's not about that. He already loved us. He wants us to know how much he loves us. I ask for worship that we sing about, that he has heard his beloved son for us, that in this New Testament time, that what Jesus has done for us, that in the darkest nights that he prayed to the Lord, that if you can, I don't want to be on that cross. If you can, but it's about your will. Because he knows that he will have to carry the burden of entire sin of all people, that he has to take up on him, so that we can receive that freedom and be loved by God. So he had to carry that sin for us, because Jesus has carried that to the cross for us. When God sees us, that he says, Jesus' precious blood, that our sin has been washed clean. That is the love. Every child he loves, he wants to recognize his love, that we have to understand when he calls out to us, that we are beloved. I really loved. So let's read it one more time. Those who seek to destroy my life shall go down to the depths of the earth. They shall be given over to the power of the sword and shall be a portion of the jackals. But the king shall rejoice in God, and all swear by him shall exult, and for the mouth of the liar will be stopped. The king here is King David. So he is about God. So he's talking about you, the one where you rely on God, you trust in the Lord, so that you will praise, that you can shout and enjoy joyfully to praise God, because people who spoke lies shall be stopped, that we have lies that spoken over our lives, that we're not good enough, that we're not good, but all that needs to stop. God says that the liars will be stopped, that we have to continue to see God's good work. That do you know your king? Do you know that he has good plans for you, that you have saved him, that you will be on the throne with him? He has a calling in your life. It's not about your education, not about how famous you are, how much money you have in your bank account, that you have chosen to be king with him. Your entire life, that you embrace his love, that you walk with him, journey with him. That this, you had to fight for this relationship. You had to tell the Lord, I want it. I earnestly seek it. That my soul earnestly seek it. That my heart desire. You know, when you seek, and when you see that person to the point that you could faint. You haven't seen those people go, fans going after celebrities? And you see this property that you love and you want to faint, right? You probably, that's how you go after celebrities. So that's how David's about, right? That earnest seek to a point that you faint, that's the flesh faints. That's the relationship, the loving relationship he has with us, that you had to fight for, that you had to say, that I earnestly seek you, my soul thirsts for you. And it doesn't matter if it's morning and night, especially difficult times, that we want to turn to you. Why do we, our church, practice so much about way up on the morning praise him? So you build us up that will naturally turn to God in difficulties. That's why we need to practice. And when he raised his hands to the Lord, his heart turned to him. In the middle of the night, when he's meditating for God, he's waiting up on Lord's presence. And he thought about God's goodness. God speaks to him, and his heart will be strengthened, and he'll rise and praise God. This is the inheritance God wants to give us. If you're willing today, in your difficult times, challenging time in your life, that in all difficulties, that you say, Lord, I'm willing to come before God, I'm willing to receive your help. that I desire when those sleepless nights that I will focus on you, that I this whole life I will earnestly seek you, that even though on the outside is dry and weary, but I know inside of me that I have to rely on you, that I have to meditate about your good work, that Jesus has accomplished great work in all of us, that he has paid a handsome ransom for us, that we can have this, especially in difficult times in your life, that you're willing to seek and turn to him, that believe all the lies spoken against you in life will be stopped, that God, your greatness, your glory, power will dwell in me, that every time we turn to him every day, will we be more like him. Brothers and sisters, I welcome you to come up front if you're willing, and worship together with our worship team. Through worship, I feel like we will have this breakthrough, especially how we see God. So every day that we will meditate about him and seek him earnestly. Brothers and sisters, welcome to come forth. Let's seek God together. Then we'll sing and worship song together. I welcome you to come up front. Come towards. Let's worship him. Give him our thanksgiving. That we'll have some time to respond. I welcome you to be bold, come up front. It's a choice that you make, that you want to draw near to him. I desire to be close to him. Every day you have to make that choice. I believe God wants to continue doing good work to draw us near to Him. But we have a choice we have to make in our lives that we want to turn to You as our priority. That my heart earnestly seek You, even in the dry, weary land. That my heart focus on You. Let's give some time to petition to the Lord. I want to turn to You. In my entire life, I want to follow You closely. I want to love You. Lord, that this is our prayer of our life, this earnest seeking, no matter what's happening in the environment that we want to, only You can satisfy our heart. Only You can strengthen us from the inside. That You are the strength that leads us that we can continue to run this race. Lord, help us. Give us strength that we can rise up. Thank You, Lord. That we want to have You. I intentionally want to go after You. Yes, Jesus, that we need You so. Lord, that our earnestly want to seek You. Jesus, we desire and hunger for You. From our heart that we cry out to You. Jesus, we cry out to You. I see You earnestly, I need You. Jesus, I need You. Jesus, I need You. I seek You. That You're the only thing that I have need. That fill me again today. Fill me with Your love. Jesus, I need You. A lot of things in this world cannot satisfy my heart, only You can. Jesus, I need You. Continue to tell the Lord with your heart. Tell Jesus how we so need You. How we cannot depart from You. That You are our life. That You are the source of our life, Lord. Jesus, we need You. Jesus, we love You. Love You with all of my life. Yes, Jesus, every time that we thought of You, Lord, get to know You, love You even more. We want to meditate about You. Your goodness, Your beauty, Your goodness, Your faithfulness. Lord, we want to meditate about You. That You love me. That You focus. That I mean, You love. You provide, You protect. You love us. You want to see us face to face.
Lord,
today, and in Your temple that we want to praise You, we want to look up on You.
We
want to see Your glory and power. My heart once again belongs to You alone. Seek after You,
God,
Son,
你如水之地，你是我的一切，我心不住思念你，只愿与你面对面。
Forever, always with you, I love you. You are my everything, all my comfort, all sweet. I long to be near Forever.Jesus, we trust you with all our life. This whole life we will follow. follow your leadership, your protection. And our whole life, that you walk and be with us. Thank you, Lord, that give us that deep desire to be light on you, that we will be raised and held by you, that we are highly favored, that we're in your hands, that your right hand will support us, that your right hand will hold on to us, that we can rely and we can grab on, that we can pray, that we praise your name. Our whole life we will rely and trust on you only. You're my only passion.
I long to be face to face.
are beautiful. I long to be
Spirit, we welcome you. Continue to release God's love pour over us, all that heart that seek you. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. In the deep depths of our hearts, continue to do your work.
You are my strength, my strength. You are my strength.
来敬拜你，你是
make my spirit
weary.
All of my heart's desire, and I long to Jesus.